Good morning. It's my great pleasure to be here with you. In my presentation, I will talk about electrification of passenger cars mobility. I will start with a brief introduction, then I will a little bit discuss the policy framework that we currently have in the EU. I will discuss different types of electric vehicles with a special focus on economic and environmental assessment. And finally, I will close my presentation with the major conclusions. As you already know, our transport sector is almost completely based on oil products. It's a least diversified energy sector, and here we have also huge energy import dependency in the most of the countries, especially from the Middle East countries. Using fossil fuels in the transport sector causes, of course, increasing greenhouse gas emissions. For example, in Europe, transport sector is responsible for about 1/4 of the total greenhouse gas emissions. And the largest amount of these emissions is caused by road transport, about 73%. And in the road transport, the largest contribution to emissions are made by cars, about 61%. So it's obvious that we need effective policies and measures which can be applied in passenger car transport and which can reduce energy consumption, mitigate global warming, as well as improve local air quality. In Europe, we have a very broad portfolio of policies which are already implemented. For example, we have a standard for CO2 emissions from the new passenger cars. The next goal to have, which have to be reached, is 95 grams CO2 per kilometer driven. This goal have to be reached by 2021. And very recently, European Parliament have decided to have further reduction of these emissions by 2030. This emission level should be reduced by 37.5%. According to the European Climate and Energy Package for 2020, the goal is to have further reduction of greenhouse gas emissions, improvement of energy efficiency, as well as increasing use of renewable energy use in electricity generation. And there is also a goal to have 10% share of renewable energy in the transport sector. To some extent, up to 7%, this can be covered by biofuels, but there is also enough space for other kinds of renewable energy for transport. In the scope of the climate package for 2030, we don't have direct target for the transport sector, but the goal is to have increasing use of renewable energy in electricity generation and making electricity more green. We are also making electric vehicles more environmentally friendly. According to the transport white paper, the goal is to have further reduction of greenhouse gas emission in 2030 and 2050, and additionally, the goal is to remove internal combustion engine at least from the urban areas, so that the number of internal combustion engine vehicles in urban areas should be reduced by 50% by 2030 and completely removed from urban areas by 2050. And already many countries have announced bans of internal combustion engine vehicles, especially diesel cars. All these measures directly or indirectly support use of electric vehicles. Moreover, also according to the Paris Declaration on Electromobility and Climate Change, the goal is to have worldwide more than 100 million electric vehicles and about 400 million two- and three-wheelers by 2030. When we are talking about electric vehicles, it's important to recognize that electric vehicles are not completely new technology. They have a long history. They entered the market already in 1830, and historical peak electric vehicles have had already in the 1912 with about 30,000 electric vehicles. At that time, electric vehicles, especially in the United States, have been more popular than conventional cars. Limited driving range of electric vehicles at that time was not the problem because the most of the roads have been in cities. However, with the improvement of internal combustion engine engine, as well as with the start of the mass production and cost reduction, as well as availability of cheap oil and extensions of the road, popularity of internal combustion engine was increasing and interest for electric vehicle was decreasing. So basically between 1930 and 1973, electric vehicles have been completely removed from the streets. The interest in electric vehicles is increasing again in 1970s, at first due to the increasing oil prices as well as more and more evident environmental problems. And especially with the use of lithium batteries, we have new increase of interest in electric vehicles starting at the beginning of 21st century. However, we can recognize that in the scope of 100 years, electric number of electric vehicles have increased from 100,000 to 180,000 electric vehicles. And the problems that we have had with electric cars 100 years ago are still the same. Higher cost than in the case in comparison to internal combustion engine vehicles, limited driving range, and limited infrastructure. When we are talking about electric vehicles, it's important to recognize that we have different type of electric vehicles with different level of electrification and different contribution to the reduction of greenhouse gas emissions. In this figure, you can see the five type of electric vehicles in comparison to internal combustion engine vehicles. First type is hybrid electric vehicles. In this case, we are still using fossil fuels to run the cars, and this type of electric vehicles can be seen as one more energy efficient internal combustion engine vehicles. For us, of special interest are rechargeable electric vehicles, such as, for example, plug-in hybrid electric vehicles. He is still hybrid technology. We have internal combustion engine and battery inside, but battery can be charged externally, and we can have a poor electric driving range between 30 and 16 kilometers driven. Then here we have also range extender. In the case of the range extender, we have inside small internal combustion engine, and fossil fuels is used just to produce electricity on board and extend driving range of battery. Of special interest are so-called zero-emission vehicles, battery electric vehicles, and fuel cells vehicles. In the case of battery electric vehicles, we have just battery inside. We can be charged externally. And special type of electric vehicles are fuel cells vehicles. Here we are using hydrogen to produce electricity and fuel cells on board. Every type of electric vehicles have some advantages and disadvantages. However, as I said, of largest interest are these rechargeable electric vehicles, and we can see that the number of electric vehicles is continuously increasing starting from about 2010. Currently, worldwide, we have about more than 5 million electric vehicles. The largest share of these vehicles is in China, about 35%, Europe about 24%, and United States about 22%. As I said, fuel cells vehicles are a special type of electric vehicles. They are currently mostly used in different kinds of demonstration and pilot projects. Worldwide, there are only about 11,200 fuel cells vehicles, and the most of them are in the United States, about 55%, Japan 26%, and in Europe the largest number is in Germany and France. Although we are talking about electrification of mobility, when we are looking at the total final electricity consumption by sector, we can see that the total electricity consumption in transport sector has a share just 1.7%. And this is actually lower than this was in 1970s. It was 2.4 at that time. So the reason for relatively, there are some reasons for relatively small, slow penetration of electric vehicles. Electric vehicles, as every technology, have some advantages and disadvantages. The major, the most important advantages of electric vehicles are high energy efficiency comparing to internal combustion engine vehicles. Then electric vehicles can contribute to the energy security. They can reduce local air pollution as well as noise level in urban areas. But there are also some disadvantages. This is high cost, limited driving range, longer charging time, as well as limited charging infrastructure. Costs are very important, and the total cost of mobility, they are dependent from the investment cost, from the vehicles, capital recovery factor, specific number of kilometers driven per year, energy price, energy intensity of the technology that we are using, as well as operating and maintenance costs. So in this figure, you can see the total cost of different type of electric vehicles in comparison to conventional internal combustion engine vehicles. The total cost given in euro per 100 kilometer driven, and they are divided in three categories: capital cost, operating and maintenance cost, and fuel cost. What you can see here is that electric vehicles have higher mobility cost, and they are especially high in the case of battery electric vehicles and fuel cells vehicles. The reason for this high cost are mostly due to the investment cost for these vehicles. As I said, hybrid electric vehicles, they are mostly currently used because they are similar to conventional cars, and also the cost of this type of electric vehicles are very competitive with conventional cars. Sorry, we can make discussion after that.
The fuel cost in relation to electric vehicles, what are you referring to?
Sorry, can we make discussion after the presentation?
We will not understand it, and we can have the discussion afterwards, okay? All right.
So, the increase of this cost are high mostly due to the battery cost. The share of the battery price in the total price of electric vehicles are between 25 and 55%. So for the future, it's very important to have further cost reduction of the batteries. But basically, on the market, we have different type of the batteries with different chemistries from different producers. But here you can see the average cost of development of the batteries, and it can be noticed that we have decreasing battery prices. The price difference between fuel cells vehicles, battery electric vehicles, as well as conventional cars, for example, in 2010, was pretty high. However, nowadays, price of fuel cells vehicles is already about 60,000 euro. Battery electric vehicles are below 40,000 euro. So through technological learning, we can count that in the future, we will have further cost reductions so that this alternative technologies could become more competitive in the future. However, in the meantime, we have this price gap between conventional cars and electric vehicles. And to close this gap, we have different kind of policies which are provided to make electric vehicles more attractive. The all policies that we currently have could be divided in two categories: monetary measures and non-monetary measures. The most important monetary measures that we have are different kind of subsidies, as well as reduction or exemptions for different taxes, such as, for example, road tax, annual circulation tax, company car tax, registration taxes, fuel consumption taxes, congestion charges, and so on. Besides these monetary measures, there are also non-monetary measures, such as, for example, possibility for electric vehicle users to have a free parking spaces, possibility for electric vehicle drivers to use bus lanes, wide availability of free charging station, as well as permission for electric vehicles to enter city center zones and zero emission zones. And depending from the country to country, as well as city to city, this non-monetary measure could be sometimes even more attractive. However, all these measures are provided why electric vehicles have been recognized as more environmentally friendly technology, which can help us to reduce total greenhouse gas emissions. Electric vehicles are oft called zero-emission vehicles, but it's important when we are talking about environmental benefits of electric vehicles, it's important to look at the whole energy supply chain, starting from the primary energy sources which we are using for electricity generation, over the car production, up to the final energy service mobility. For example, battery electric vehicles and fuel cells vehicles have zero emission, but just the one part of this energy supply chain, just at the point of view. But in the whole energy supply chain, we will always have some emissions. For example, here you can see the CO2 emission per kilometer driven for different type of electric vehicles in comparison to conventional cars. In the case of conventional cars, the largest amount of emissions are caused during fuel use in the vehicles. This is this red part. With hybrid cars, which are more energy efficient, we can have slightly lower total emission per kilometer driven. In the case of plug-in hybrid and range extender vehicles, we have a combination of gasoline as well as electricity, and the total emissions are very dependent on how we are using car, to which extent we are using internal combustion engine, to which extent we are using battery, as well as which kind of electricity we are using in battery. And finally, the largest reduction of the total emissions could be reached with the poor battery electric vehicles and fuel cells vehicles in the case that electricity and hydrogen are produced from renewable energy sources. In this case, we have significant reduction comparing to the internal combustion engine vehicles. However, if we are using all coal power plants to produce electricity and then using this electricity in electric vehicles, total emission could be even higher. So the full benefits of electric vehicles we have in combination with electricity from renewable energy sources. However, which kind of electricity will be used in vehicles, electric vehicles, is different from country to country, and it's also changeable over time. Here you can see the development of the electricity mix in EU28, and you can see here that in Europe we have increasing use of renewable energy sources and decreasing use of petroleum. However, situation in Europe is very different from country to country. We have some countries, for example, Sweden, with a very low carbon intensity of the electricity mix, and on the other side also Greece, with a very high carbon intensity. So the environmental impact of electric vehicles will be different across European countries. To stress this even more, I will here show two examples, Norway and China. Both these countries are very active in the promotion and use of electric vehicles. However, in Norway you can see that almost 98% of the electricity is produced from renewable energy sources. And using electric vehicles in Norway will reduce local air pollution as well as reduce global greenhouse gas emissions. In the case of China, we have very high share of coal in electricity mix, so that use of electric vehicles can reduce local air pollution, what is for China also very important, but will not lead to the reduction on the global level. So basically, if we are using same type of electric vehicles in different countries, the total CO2 emission per kilometer driven could be very different. Here you can see example of Norway and China, and difference is huge. So the problem that we actually have is that we have a car-oriented mobility. The number of vehicles is continuously increasing, as well as size of vehicle. This leads to congestions. To avoid congestion, we are increasing number of the road. This could be solution in the short term, but in long term, this leads to more cars to additional congestion, and we have a crisis. And the result of such car-oriented mobility is situation like this. We have a huge road with very powerful cars on it, but in an average speed of about 15 kilometers per hour. And also, if you replace all these cars with electric vehicles, we will still have a problem. So for the future, it's very important to improve the energy efficiency of mobility, and actually on three levels: system efficiency, travel efficiency, as well as vehicle efficiency. System efficiency means that we have to avoid unnecessary travel and to reduce trip distances, and this is very dependent on the city development urban planning. Further, it's important to shift toward more sustainable modes. It's important to have possibilities for safe walking, biking, as well as to have availability of public transport. And further, it's important to improve energy efficiency of technology that we are using. Electric vehicles are more energy efficient technology. However, they are even more energy efficient if they are used in different kinds of car sharing or other fleets, so that we have also to improve our transport practices. So I'm coming to the conclusions. Electric vehicles are the part of the solution for the problems that we have. However, we need further cost reduction. We have to need to improve the battery characteristics so that we can have a longer driving range, as well as we need further development of the infrastructure. As I showed, we have currently different kind of monetary, non-monetary measures which are provided to support use of electric vehicles. But we have to recognize that all these measures will be abolished with the increasing number of electric vehicles. If we have a high number of electric vehicles, we cannot provide free parking spaces for all cars or possibility to use bus lanes or tax exemptions. So we will need a new policy design, and it's very important that this future policy design ensure that we have a high environmental benefits of electric vehicles. And this full environmental benefits of electric vehicles we have only in combination with electricity from renewable energy sources. So it's a huge challenge for the future to provide clean energy sources for electricity generation in the future. And however, all problems in the transport sector cannot be solved with the electric vehicles. We need also new mobility behavior. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Reinhard, for this very nice introduction, and thank you for you to being here. What we are talking about energy storing systems in the narrow sense, and if you want to structure, you see a lot of technologies there, and there are two which play actually in the present discussion in the major role. One is the lithium-ion batteries, which are here marked in red, and then on the bottom line, hydrogen and methane type of energy storage system, which is again marked in red. What is the difference between these two technologies? One is the efficiency. The lithium-ion battery is highly efficient, with the average fuel efficiency of better than 95%, so that's very good. Unfortunately, you cannot store energy for long periods. Typical storage duration is hours or below hours and days. And on the other side, we have hydrogen and methane. The problem of this technology is they have very low fuel efficiency. And the advantage, if you need seasonal energy storage, probably hydrogen and methane would be the choice from a engineering point of view. To look a little bit what is this hydrogen and methane technology, you see here on the left side, there is electricity you put into an electrolyzer, you get hydrogen out of this. Maybe you are happy with the hydrogen, then you have a fuel efficiency of 70%, about, maybe a little bit better, but on average 70%. If you cannot use the hydrogen because there is no demand for hydrogen or not sufficient demand, or you have not the infrastructure for hydrogen, you have to do the methane synthesis. And for this, you need CO2 wherever you get it from, maybe from the atmosphere, maybe you capture from fossil fueled power station, or you can get it from biomass production. Then you put this CO2 into a methane synthesis generator. Again, you lose some fuel efficiency, and at the end you have the total, at the end you get methane rich gas, which you can feed in the existing pipeline. You can use the existing infrastructure. That's the benefit of this process. But of course, the chain efficiency from electricity to gas is less than 60%. So that means you lose a lot of primary energy. And another thing is the investment cost of this technology per unit of output is quite high. And to my view, this creates an economic pressure towards baseload electricity generation. For me, when we discussed hydrogen in the 80s, Heo Wagner yesterday talked something about this. Hydrogen was proposed by people who like nuclear because they say this can use, then we can use a baseload nuclear power station. You put an electrolyzer at the end, and then we have a baseload electricity and a baseload hydrogen, so we can produce any type of energy we want to have. So this is the situation from an engineering point of view. What is the situation from the economic point of view? Levelized costs of batteries, and here is a simple example. We assume the cost of the storage system may be 6,000 euros. It is a system, not only the battery stack, because you must integrate it somewhere in the electric system. So let's assume 6,000 euros. Maybe the rated size of the storage system is a small one, 10 kilowatt hours. Depth of discharge, inclusive average degradation over lifetime, 80%, number of storage cycles over the lifetime, 7,000 cycles. That means one cycle per day means 20 years lifetime. It is extremely long. And energy efficiency of the storage system, as we have seen before, 95. What is the cost of levelized cost of storage in the case of such battery? The cost is 11.28 cents per kilowatt hour or 130 euros per megawatt hour. That is simply the capital cost, not the operation cost, not the price to buy the electricity, only the capital, the levelized cost of storage, only the investment part of the story. So this is a lot of money compared to the wholesale electricity prices. Low, so of course, why we want to have this technology? We want to store electricity. We have periods in a high renewable electricity scenario. This is an example from a PhD thesis I did together with Heo Wagner. And this is an example sample week in summer. We see the solar in yellow. We see the onshore and offshore wind in gray. And the red is the power demand. And you see there are days in which we have more electricity generation. And in this week, there are also some days with less electricity week. If we could have a storage capacity which would cover this difference between production and demand, then we could have a 100% renewable system for this week in this example, simply, but we need to store electricity for these 3 days. And if we make the same kind of calculus in a different way, this was the result of a model, again, from Große Böckmann in 2010. If you have a higher share of renewable electricity without storage, then you cannot use this electricity because you produce more electricity than the demand is. And the usable electricity, you can, of course, expand the production, the capacity of the generation. You will never reach 100% renewable electricity simply because there are some holes in the hours in which you cannot have enough electricity. So even if you have 4 times or 5 times its capacity as compared to today, then you will not have 100% renewable electricity without storage. And the gray area is that electricity which could be produced, which cannot be used in the case if you don't have energy storage. So this is the potential of the energy storage in the future electricity system. So that is the story why electricity storage, of course. Now, how to do the economics of this? Maybe we look in the market, and the market, the day-ahead market, we have a number of hours now in which the electricity prices is negative. You see the number of hours which, in which this is the case is growing in the case of Germany between 2010 and 2019. Even if we have only a part of a year, we have more negative hours with negative prices than every year before. So the number of hours is increasing. But the minimal price is not decreasing. That means we have somehow a plateau around 60 to 80 euros per minus 60 to minus 80 euros per ton. And why is this so? This is simply because the result of regulation of the electricity system. If you want to get more information, we can discuss later. And what I think, this regulation can change. And if it is happen, it is easy to change this regulation in such a way that you will never see negative prices again. So you cannot rely storage systems based on negative prices. That is the conclusion of this slide. It's simply the result of regulation and not the result of market force. The next thing is, of course, we don't need negative prices. We need the price margin, the price spread, maybe the daily price spread, and we use the battery or the energy storage. We buy the electricity when it is cheap. You sell the electricity when it's expensive, so the price spread allows me to finance the investment. Of course, if we do this, we should look at different power markets. We could look at the forward market, you could look at the day-ahead market, the intraday market, etc. And if we do this for, in the case of the day-ahead market, these are the price spreads up to 21st of August this year. You see the daily maximum price, the daily minimum price, and the average price. You see there are some hours in which we have negative prices up to minus 80%, and we have 1 hour in which has a positive price, 120 euros, but it's only this large price difference was happening only once a year, so we cannot use energy storage based on one operation per year. So that means we have to analyze this in more detail, and this is the way how I propose to do it. You calculate an ordered daily price spread curve. That means the first hour is the hour, the first number is the day in which the spread is maximum. You see a little bit more than 100 euros between high price of the day and low price of the day. And then we see a lot of hours in which the price spread is below 40 euros. The daily price spread is below 40 euros. And assuming you need 40 euros to operate your variable cost, then you would see you have about 40 days in which you can run you would have been successfully run this operation. But you see there is no single hour, no single day in this year in which the price spread was more than 120 euros so that to cover the fixed costs. So as we can see today, there is no chance to cover the fixed costs if we operate on the wholesale market or on the day-ahead market. The same situation also if you took the prices of 2018. Again, you see the maximum price, the maximum price spread was around 100 euro. Again, similar. And then the price curve goes down. The price spread curve goes down. And if you took the margin of 40 euros, you could say every fourth day you could operate, you could have a price spread, a daily price spread of more than 40 euros per day. Cumulative price spreads are small compared to typical storage costs. In addition, why we need these 40 euros we have to pay? If you put electricity into our battery, you have to maybe pay the grid fees, the electricity taxes, the levies, and other kind of costs. So that means electricity storage, if you buy electricity, even if the electricity on the wholesale market is zero or it's negative, you have to pay something in order to get the electricity in your battery, except you get some political subsidies, exemption from paying taxes and grid fees, etc. And an example for the German case in 2016, you see what is the average purchase from the grid, the grid fee and all these levies, depending on, of course, how you operate your storage capacity. It is between 20 and 120 euros per megawatt hour. Or these are the fees which you have to pay if you are not exempted, if you get not a kind of subsidy for operating your storage. That means the economics of this is at least infeasible as far as we have not a solution for this grid fees and this renewable energy levies, etc., etc. So what are the solutions for this storage? The first one, of course, you can say, if somebody wants to invest into a storage, he say, I want to get a subsidy, and the government say, okay, you get reduction of all these kind of levies. But of course, this means high regulatory complexity, and of course, this is state planning. It's not really a market. Next solution would be shift from energy-related grid fees to load-related grid fees, maybe including levies. This would be a new regulatory process. It is easy to think about this system, but the change from the present system to another system is quite complicated, in particular if you have not load-measured customers. If you have load-measured customers, you have already load-related grid fees, so that means an additional megawatt hour of electricity you take into storage will not cost you so much grid costs, but in the case of retailers which have not yet load measurement, a solution is difficult. And again, not sufficient for making energy storage economic. Solution three, replacing the remaining electricity levy through CO2 taxes. This is, of course, something what is very interesting. Make the electricity cheaper so that it is easier to store electricity. On the other hand, make fossil fuels more expensive. So if you replace this stored electricity, you replace gas or fossil fuels by this, then, of course, it is a double effect. So I think this would help a little bit to develop this sector, but maybe it is not. In addition, of course, we calculated about what would this mean in Germany. We would have about 40 tons on top of the present emission trading system of the European Union. We would have to introduce a CO2 tax of about 40 euros per ton CO2 on top. And of course, this would be political very difficult, because it is clear that all these companies which are already subject to this emission trade will say, we don't want to pay. So 50% of the emissions will not be subject to this CO2 tax. The other 50% may then have not 40 euros per ton, but 80 euros per ton, and then you create another type of problem. So this is politically difficult. Solution four, which is the most likely solution, companies in a monopolistic position, for example, grid operators, they are allowed to transfer the cost of energy storage to their customers via the grid fees, and then, of course, it is, of course, storage becomes a political part of the grid assets, and that's exactly what's happened in the German market. So is this a solution? Maybe at the beginning it is a solution, but it's not really a solution for the market. And one of the key problems here is what we call cannibalization of storage investment. Here you see at the beginning you have a price spread, 20 euros and 60, that means 40 euros price spread, a daily price spread. And if you start to increase your storage capacity, which is available to the market, there is some storage capacity in which the price spread becomes zero. There is no storage, no price spread anymore. You can eliminate all price spread if the storage capacity is big enough. We calculated this for the German market, day-ahead market. This is about this Niels Ehlers PhD thesis, saying this is at the end, there would be no. So then what happens if you have a certain size of the storage? Then you create a storage surplus. That means the price spread is reduced a little bit. What is the earnings of the storage earnings is the reduced price spread times the capacity of the storage. Then you have a consumer surplus because the price maximum is smaller, and your producer surplus because the minimum is smaller. And you have a welfare loss because you have not fully eliminated the price spread. So that means if you are already in the sporing market as a company, you want to eliminate newcomers because this will reduce your price spread. That is what we call cannibalization. That means once if you are there, you will try to kick out all the others. So this is an interesting market for storage. Here is again from the PhD thesis of Niels Ehlers. What are the number of cycles which you have? And it's exactly the story told in a different way. If you have not very much capacity, storage capacity, let us take the example of solar, the yellow line, then you have more than one cycle per day, because you have the peak at noon, and so you can use electricity, the production photovoltaic production peak at noon, so you can store this electricity, use it in the afternoon. In the night you have low consumption, you take electricity from the grid and you can use it in the morning. So you can have two cycles per day. But after some capacity, then you have only one cycle, etc. And at the end, you end up with weekly cycles. And this is for wind energy the same. And if you take the whole electricity, intermittent renewable electricity, assuming here 75,000 megawatts, how many storage you can get, you see there are some potential for daily storage, but if you have a storage capacity of more than 2,000 megawatt hours, then there is no chance for daily storage anymore. So, but of course, the chances are positive. We can say we have actually the ordered load curve. We will have the residual load after we have taken care of the renewable energy. That means the energy below the blue line is the contribution of dispatchable power plants. And you see here, it is easy. Then you can say, instead of having so many dispatchable power stations, we can use excess electricity during the hours when there is price negative. Use it when the production of electricity is higher than the demand, and we use this electricity in the other hours. Of course, maybe we have to store it over more than only a day or something like that. So that means this could be a good situation. And of course, if you look forward into the future, we assume that this residual load cost goes down. That means the remaining part for fossil power stations becomes smaller, and you see the triangle where we have more electricity than needed becomes larger. That means more storage capacity. And in addition, you have a longer period in which you can use electricity, and also longer period in which you can sell electricity from the storage. This is the perspective. But of course, we have still this limited capacity, limited volume of profitable investment due to this cannibalization effect, and also due to the high cost of storage. So, promising strategies for storage investment. If I had to tell you only something negative, that's not very interesting. So, what could be the solution for the storage? First solution is focus on storage with low investment expenditures, or where major components of the storage system already are existing. And this is an example for the case for power to heat. Power to heat, usually you have already a hot water storage. And if you use electricity in the existing hot water storage, then you don't have to invest into a storage. You have to only invest into a very cheap system. So this can be attractive. A fleet of electric vehicles, the same thing which we have discussed before. If there are already batteries because you have this electrical car, then you can use the storage is not expensive anymore. And the third example, which is, of course, to my view, the most important one, demand-side management. You don't have to invest except into some logic statistic, some computer programs. You have already the storage capacity. So that is the first option for storage system. Second is operate storage systems beyond the wholesale electricity market. We don't need to use it on the day-ahead market or on the wholesale market. We can use it on the retail market. And the retail price in Germany is 30 cents per kilowatt hour. If my storage costs 11 cents per kilowatt hour, it seems to be attractive. So the problem of this decentralized energy system is if you have not many of them, then it is no problem. But if there are many decentralized systems, you probably need some central dispatch, a central control of this. And that is the challenge of this market. If everybody consumes electricity when it wants, then it would or store electricity when it's wants, then it could create instabilities in the grid. And of course, if you want to control this, you will never be able to control this by a single price, because then everybody will do the same thing. There must be more complex control necessary. What is the managing cost of this kind of control, and at what conditions customers may accept this kind of control? You don't buy a storage in order to allow the grid manager to play with this. You want to use the storage for your own needs. So that is a problem which I see in the future. Another option, which is not realistic to my view, is why not inducing capacity payments for certain wholesale storage system? And we have capacity payments in the German market in the secondary control power, an example. And what you see here, the positive and negative capacity payments are declining over time. There is an exception. Wie geht das weg? Scheiße. Yes, there is an exception in the year 2019, but this is due to a regulatory abnormality, and as far as I've learned from recent news, the federal grid regulator is trying to abolish this regulation. You see the result is we have still very low capacity prices. So that means if you introduce a capacity market, you are not sure that the capacity market guarantees prices which are high enough to finance storage systems. So, and the last option is, of course, demand-side management. This is the case when there is a shortage of electricity. We have very high prices, but instead of very high prices, you can say if the demand elasticity is larger, then the price spread will be shrinked. So, this all challenges the investments into electric storage systems, and what we have to recognize at the end, if we invest into capital-intensive, the only option which, to my view, is feasible on the medium-term scale is grid companies must invest into storage, or others will lose money. And of course, these are the conclusions, and we have to accept that if we use capital-intensive storage system, even if it is a grid operator who does it, it creates economic pressure towards base load electricity. I remember this idea of former nuclear engineers to say, if we have a hydrogen system, then we have a demand for our nuclear power station. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Reinhard, for inviting me, and it's really a great honor to be able to speak in front of this distinguished audience. I was asked to speak about energy efficiency, but I have deliberately chosen to narrow it down a bit to energy efficiency policy, and I also narrow down the region that I'm going to talk about to Central Europe, because obviously this is a region that I know the most, but I hope that still some of the challenges that I'm going to talk about are, well, if not universal, then definitely, I think, transferable to other countries as well. There are one or two key points that I want to make throughout my talk. And the first one is sort of background statement, which I need to make, and which is that energy efficiency in Central Europe is not high on agenda among the politicians, especially. And I think this is something we need to keep in mind, and this also leads to the other message and to the other challenge that I'm going to talk about. Sorry? Can you hear me? Is there, can you hear me? So we've heard yesterday that the world is really changing fast, and for that we need smart regulation, smart regulators. And I would extend it to smart policy. And we can't have a good policy without having good data and good monitoring system. This is not a surprising statement, but the thing is that in Central Europe, we currently lack this good data very much. And I'm going to try to give some examples from our region why I think this is the case. So before plunging into the examples and into the messages. Just a brief overview of where we are now. We've heard already quite many times about the targets that we have. The targets that either sufficient or insufficient should sort of lead us, guide us in the way where we're heading with the policy. In energy efficiency, the target is 32.5% by 2030. This is the binding target for the whole EU, and all the member states should be setting their own indicative targets that should all together lead to this overall target of 32.5%. The important question is, are we there yet? Are we heading there? And the very simple answer is no, we're not. And you can see it on the picture here. This is the primary and final energy consumption for the whole EU. And you can see that there was a decline a couple of years ago, but it mostly coincided with the slowdown of the GDP. And you can see that in the last couple of years, the energy consumption, both final and primary, is going up again and going distant from the targets that we have for 2030. The same applies for our region. This is just an example for Czechia, and you will see that the pattern is more or less the same. What are the main sort of reasons or why the energy consumption is behaving as it is? This is a graph by Odyssey Muir database. It's a decomposition graph showing what are the reasons, what are the changes, structural changes in energy consumption in the last 15 or 16 years. And this is for the whole EU, and you can see that basically the energy efficiency gains are offset by three main components in the whole EU. It's the activity, which is basically the growth in value added in all the sectors, the demography, so more people, and also the lifestyle. So we have bigger flats, we have more cars, etc. Very similar picture for our region, for the V4 countries, with a slight difference, I think, in the structural changes. So in our region, there are also structural changes in the whole industry and in the whole economy, which also led to a decline in energy, the overall energy consumption. The same for Slovakia, for instance. In Poland and in Hungary, the energy efficiency gains do not even offset the changes in activity. So there the consumption is actually growing quite significantly in both countries. The low preference to energy efficiency in our region is well documented in the comments to the National Energy and Climate Plans. So every country had to come up with a draft of National Energy and Climate Plan by the end of 2018, where they should say how they will sort of reach all the targets of the under the energy governance regulation. And the Commission gave its comments in June. And in our countries, I think you can very much see the pattern of very limited level of detail of the energy efficiency measures. All the measures or the targets are lack ambitiousness, and the measures are too general. They lack detail in quantifying the impacts that they should have, and also in the description, that we just lack the level of detail, and this is very much common to all the countries in our region. Um, So going to the examples where I think we really need more details and more data, and we currently lack them, is first of all monitoring and evaluation of the outcomes of the policy energy efficiency policy measures. So far, many of the programs just provide the very core indicators of the outcomes. For instance, the kilowatt hours saved that have to be reported, the tons of emissions saved, but we don't usually get more details on why this is happening, more structures in the measures or in the energy carriers and whatsoever. This is especially the case for the ex post evaluation of the program. So knowing what are the real savings compared to the ex ante evaluations. One example for all, a new green savings program. This is a flagship program in Czechia for households. This is a program that's been running since 2009, and since then it distributed almost 2 billion euros, which came from the sale of, first of all, emission assigned amount units, AAUs, and then from emission allowances. And it's a program that supports single family houses. It supports improvements in thermal properties of buildings, renewables, and heat sources, etc. And it's a program it's a subsidy program, so it subsidizes investment costs purely. Since 2009, there were over 85,000 applications available or submitted to the program. It was one of the requirements of the buyers of the assigned amount units to carry out ex post evaluation of this program. So this was carried out in 2012, and the inspectors, together with researchers, went into 124 houses to see what the real savings were supported by the program. Probably not surprisingly, on average, the real savings were found to be 25% lower than was the estimate. This was done based on billing, so the inspectors would look at the invoices. I think the two points that I want to make here are, first of all, that what I think was interesting in this study is that they were personal visits, so the inspectors went into the houses and together with the researchers, and they could both talk to the owners but also see for themselves what the reasons were behind the difference in the ex ante or the anticipated savings and the real savings. And the visits were not connected with any legal repercussions, so the owners knew there wouldn't be any sort of aftermath after the visit. And the second point I think that is important here with respect to the data and to having the data in hand is that this type of study has never been replicated. Even though it didn't cost too much and it provided a lot of interesting data, it hasn't been replicated ever since because it's not been the requirement of the buyers anymore, I think. So now in this program, in this huge program, we are back to just a very simple core indicators to know what's going on. The second point, the second example is administrative intensity of the programs of the energy efficiency policies. We know that transaction costs impact negatively the overall efficiency of the policy. This is a well-known fact, but in the same time, the transaction costs are rarely or almost never counted in the cost evaluation of and the overall effectiveness of the program. An example for all, again, we did a study of two major operational programs in Czechia. There are programs financed through the structural funds of the EU, And we found that in these programs, which are focused on public organizations and one program and the second one on private enterprises, the transaction costs would amount from 10 to 25% of the project costs. But importantly, we could see sort of large economies of scale. So in smaller projects, the transaction costs would be much higher. And we couldn't do this study for the household, but I suspect that in the very small projects, for instance, household, the transaction costs would be even higher. But you don't see it in the cost in the policy evaluation. The other important point is that even though we would expect the transaction costs to be decreasing over time, due to learning, due to fixed costs, initial costs at the beginning, we don't see it happening. We do have data for like a long-term data in the project, in the two programs, but transaction costs do not decrease over time due to other reasons. There are many exogenous factors, the programs change, the other factors outside the programs change, and so the transaction costs do not decrease over time. And a third, last point, and here I'm gonna step out a little bit out of the region, is about the climate investment as such. We know that in order to reach the climate and energy targets, energy efficiency, but the other targets as well, we will need substantial amounts of investment, but we know surprisingly very little about what's going on in the investment right now. What is the landscape? These two very small maps, I'm sorry about that, but I think you can get the point, represent to what extent the information, because every member state is obliged to put this information in the NECP, and these two maps show to what extent the member states were able to incorporate the information about the investment needs and about the investment landscape, so the current status, into their national energy climate plans. And you can see that while we seem to have, well, many countries have quite a good idea about the investment needs, we seem to have very little idea about the current investment flows and what's going on right now. The only exception would be France, where actually the landscape analysis has been going on since 2011. It's been done by the Institute for Climate Economics, and that's why the data is ready there. This is an example, and this, why this is important, and I'm taking an example from the study of the Institute for Climate Economics, is because obviously there is a gap. So this is the blue bars represent the investment landscape as they were able to track it. And the green bars represent the investment needs according to the targets in France. And you can see that we are just not, or at least in France, but I suspect in other countries too, we may not be investing enough. In Czechia, we've done a similar exercise right now, similar analysis, and this is, I'm going to make a little advertisement here. If you want to know more about this research, please be welcome to join me tomorrow at the concurrent session. But again, two points that I want to highlight here. First of all, so we tracked only two sectors, energy and buildings for now. And in buildings, we were able to track the investment in energy efficiency and renewable energy sources of 15.6 billion Czech crowns. And you can see that the Ministry of Industry and Trade estimated in order to reach our energy efficiency targets, we might need 400 to 600 billion Czech crowns in the 10-year period, so roughly 40 to 60 billion Czech crowns yearly to be invested in order to reach our targets. And the second point is this big gray area, the big gray circle, if you're able to see it, which represents the lack of data we have about the private sector. We know that most of the investment have to come from the private sector, but we do have very limited data on what's going on in the private sector. Even though it's not straightforward in the public sector either, in the public intermediaries, but it's even more blurry in the private sector. So to conclude, we have a quite substantial amount of investment to make in energy efficiency and in climate and energy in general. But we definitely need, I think, to be better in tracking, especially private finance, so that we know the grounds that we are building the huge skyscraper on. And in the monitoring and evaluation, we need better systemic monitoring and evaluation of not only the benefits of the programs, but also the costs, including transaction costs. And when we do that, then there is definitely room for introducing a wider plethora of financial and other energy efficiency instruments. So thank you for your attention.